Have you wondered why the news media reports negative incidents overwhelmingly more than positive ones? Or why outrage, hate, and fear go viral on social media every day? Researchers have observed that bad impacts us more negatively than good impacts us positively. This tendency is called the negativity bias, and in this video, we look at how it works, why it exists, and how you can use it to your advantage while avoiding its pitfalls. But let's start by looking at an example of negativity bias in Sidney Lumet's searing satire of ratings-driven news media, Network. In the 1970s, primetime programming on news networks is filled with images of violence and chaos, a desperate strategy of news executives to attract more eyeballs. Howard Beale is an aging TV anchorman who's fired after his ratings have been steadily deteriorating. He reacts to this by sensationally announcing on live television his intention to commit suicide on air. Beale's televised meltdown gives the show a huge ratings boost, and as a result, he's given his own show as the mad prophet of the airwaves. As Beale's mental health deteriorates, one of his angry televised rants culminates in his insisting that people go to their windows and yell,
"I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not gonna take this anymore!"
This stunt makes Beale a major TV icon and one of the most valuable assets to the company that controls his news network. The success of Beale's rants and raves allows the network to develop even more outrageous programming, a concept that is taken to unsettling extremes. We will come back to this story at the end of the video, but before we move forward, do remember to press the like button and subscribe to the channel if you like the video. You can find the transcripts and references on gonudgeyourself.com and follow me on Twitter for more updates on topics in behavioral sciences. Now, let's get started. Negativity bias is defined as the tendency for negative information, events, and stimuli to have a greater impact on human cognition, emotions and behavior than comparably positive instances. This tendency is pervasive, found in our psychological processes as well as our interpersonal interactions, in connections with decisions about the future as well as memories of the past. We pay more attention to negative information, we recall negative events better than positive ones, and we feel negative emotions more intensely than positive emotions. One of the most well-known and well-studied manifestations of negativity bias is loss aversion. Consider a bet being offered to you. Think of the amount of money you need to have a sumptuous meal at your favorite neighborhood restaurant. You have to bet this amount of money. Let's say it's $20. Once you bet $20, one of two digits, either 1 or 0, is randomly generated with equal chances. If 0 appears, you lose your $20, and if 1 appears, you win $20 in addition to your own $20. Of course, you can reject the bet if you like. Now take a second to think about it. Would you like to take this bet with equal chances of losing $20 and winning $20? If you decide not to take the bet, would you take it if you were offered equal chances of losing $20 and winning $30? Those who still don't want to take the bet, what amount should be offered to you in this game for you to accept a 50% chance of losing your $20? Researchers have found that when the stakes are real, that is, people actually win or lose money in the bet, an average individual accepts to take the bet only when $30 to $50 are offered against their $20. These results show that people avoid losses more than they seek gains, a tendency known as loss aversion. To understand negativity bias better, let's start by looking at its cognitive causes, which are the psychological mechanisms that explain the bias. Negativity bias manifests in four different ways. Firstly, negative potency means that negative experiences, emotions, and memories are stronger and more intense than positive ones. What this implies is that the feeling of sadness is more negative than the feeling of happiness is positive. Second, steeper negative gradients mean that we are more sensitive to increase in negativity than increase in positivity. Now, what that implies is that an increase in pain is felt more intensely than an equivalent increase in pleasure. Third, negativity dominance means that the negativity of a negative entity is greater than the positivity of an equivalent positive entity. For example, we saw that we fear losing $20 much more than we are attracted towards gaining $20. And fourth, negative differentiation means that we perceive negative entities more vividly, have more complex and varied representations of them and respond to them in more complex manners compared to positive ones. For example, in most languages, negative feeling words far outnumber positive feeling words. Next, experienced and anticipated negative events orient us towards the risks and rewards in our environment, such that we focus more attention on navigating these risks and rewards. As a result, we are more attentive and regulate our behavior more deliberately in relation to negative events. Now, let's look at what's going on in the brain when we experience or exhibit the negativity bias. A number of brain regions have been observed to be involved in producing the negativity bias. Firstly, amygdala detects negative stimuli and inputs the information to other brain regions. Next, insula integrates information about the negative value of stimuli from amygdala and other sources and predicts how the negative stimuli is likely to affect us. Also, anterior cingulate cortex regulates our attention and monitors for errors in our predictions and expectations. Together, insular and cingulate cortex form our brain's defensive system, which signals and responds to potential threats. Next, striatum is responsible for our avoidance tendency towards negative stimuli, and it also updates the negative or positive value of stimuli based on our experiences and prediction errors. The net result of all this activity is the prediction of a negative future state, leading to expression of fear and anxiety, which drive our tendency to avoid the negative stimuli. Also, striatum displays what is known as neural loss aversion. That is, the activity in striatum decreases as loss increase, but the activity decreases faster than the rate at which it increases for gains. Now, let's try to understand why humans exhibit negativity bias. After all, for us to have inherited this tendency from our ancestors, it must exhibit at least a few evolutionary advantages. There is a natural inequality between negative and positive events. Extreme negative events are more threatening than extreme positive events are beneficial. A clear example here is death, a final and irreversible event. The positive value of a good meal or a fit mate can never be equivalent to the negative value of death. So, avoiding risks of death must be a matter of utmost priority in the evolutionary scheme. And the same goes for avoiding injuries, losses, and sickness, each of which can have irreversible negative consequences. But there's a problem here. If we are driven only by negative instincts, we would miss a lot of beneficial opportunities to seek rewarding experiences. Therefore, when there is insufficient information available about a new stimulus, we exhibit a weak drive to approach it rather than avoid it. This drive is known as positivity offset, and when combined with the negativity bias, we have the benefit of exploring our environment in the absence of any negative input, and rapid self-preservative behavior at the very slight hint of negative input. Also, in many situations, losses and threats signal greater resources and potential opportunities. For example, a plant with more defensive mechanisms such as toxins and thorns often bears the sweetest and most nutritious fruit. So it may be evolutionarily adaptive to keep alert and focused in situations of losses to be able to identify opportunities to reap greater rewards. And lastly, it may be that humans pay more attention to and respond to negative information quicker because it signals a need for change and prompts self-regulation. Through self-regulation, an organism can change and adapt itself to fit its environment. As a result, organisms that are more attuned to negative information will adapt better to their environment and be evolutionarily fitter. Now, let's look at some of the undesirable impacts of negativity bias. Negativity bias impacts many different kinds of behaviors and decisions. Indeed, it has even been shown to impact the performance of professional sportsmen. A study found that professional golfers hit birdie putts, which is seen as a highly positive score, less accurately and less hard compared to par putts, which is seen as a neutral or negative score. In a completely different domain, a study on court decisions observed negativity bias in judgments on losses. For example, in cases of negligence, compensation is more likely to be awarded for expenses already incurred than unrealized profits. Another domain where we find a strong negativity bias is news media. A study which measured viewers' reactions to actual news content, such as their heart rate and their skin conductance, showed that negative news elicits stronger and longer lasting reactions compared to positive news. Another study conducted on Twitter found that negative news content is more viral than positive content. Next, studies have found that positively framed incentives are less motivating than negatively framed incentives. For example, bonus given for good performance at the end of the year versus bonus given at the beginning of the year and then deductions made subsequently for poor performance. Even though the latter was found to be more effective, individuals incorrectly predicted that they would perform better with positive incentive. Next, people are more likely to find negatively framed information to be true compared to positively framed information. A study found that when divorce data was presented negatively, that is in terms of proportion of marriages divorced within 10 years, more individuals judged it to be true compared to framing it positively, that is number of marriages lasting 10 years or longer. Another study found that in a blind game, participants were more likely to believe that they were playing against real humans rather than computers when they lost or experienced negative outcomes. And finally, let's look at some strategies to avoid the undesirable impacts of negativity bias and use it to our advantage. First, the negativity bias is weaker when the magnitude of losses or negativity is small. Indeed, when an alternative is advantageous overall but includes some minor losses or negativity, its attractiveness may actually increase compared to a completely positive alternative. This is known as the blemish effect, and the reason behind this pattern may be that the small amount of negativity leads to more attention on the alternative, such that its overall positivity becomes more salient. Next, negativity bias has been observed mostly in situations where negative and positive alternatives are compared directly against each other. The bias is weaker when the alternatives are judged separately, that is, by the same person and on the same scale, but not directly against each other. Another situation where the negativity bias fails to appear is in online consumer reviews, where the quality of information is more important and impactful on consumer behaviors rather than whether the review is negative or positive. Similarly, on social media platforms, negativity bias has not been observed for content other than news media. And lastly, women and older individuals are more loss averse, although negativity bias in attention and memory is known to decrease with age. Conservatives display more negativity bias compared to liberals, and individuals with lower information about a certain topic are more negativity biased about that topic. And finally, people from highly individualistic, hierarchical, and masculine cultures tend to display more loss aversion. To conclude, let's look back at the story of Howard Beale. Beale's televised anger and outrage literally goes viral across the nation. This highly negative content not only keeps people glued to their TV screens, but engages their brain's defensive systems, so they feel they actually need to respond to the negative information. Beale's stunts reveal the power of negative content to drive action among the masses, and the network executives realize that they had possessed a golden egg-laying goose all along. Go watch this extremely prescient movie to find out what happens to Howard Beale and to the network executives who make a sensation out of Beale's deteriorating mental health. Thanks again for watching. And remember, before the libertarian paternalists come to nudge you, you better go nudge yourself. See you next time.